Hello, my name is Michael Zanheis, and welcome to Steel Hall, where in a few short hours, the Department of Music and Theater is going to be putting on an original production of Yet Another Funeral, an original musical written by Dom and Anthony Carolla, Dominic being an actual student here at Cal U. I am absolutely astounded that we are doing an original musical here at California University of Pennsylvania. It is absolutely wonderful. And now I'm going to have a few people to talk to about Yet Another Funeral. So let's swing it over there. Okay, I'm here with Nick, Sydney, Kayla, and Clayton. And they are all seasoned veterans of the Cal U Music and Theater. And so compared to other musicals that you've worked with, how is this musical's process different or better or worse? So
Much different. There was a long process of just going through and figuring out who we were, how our movements were. We had 2 or 3 weeks just of dance itself. And it was a difficult process. It was much harder than any process I've ever been through with a project, but it was fun and rewarding, and I would do it again.
It's glad that it was rewarding and you got something out of it.
Being that this was all original, it was just so much, just like Clayton said, with the characters finding out who we were and what we did and like the different movement in the dance pieces. It's not typical theater movement. It's a lot of inner feelings put outward, and that to me is crazy, but it is so, it's challenging and it was rewarding too. It was very different.
Did you guys like the movement? Did you like how it was different and what was good and what was bad about it?
So everything is based on how you feel, and each character you'll see has a character movement. So for example, mine would be like grabbing my arm because it feels like close to home, and like I go into my husband. So it's really about finding your character and finding a movement that fits your character well to express what you're trying to convey.
Yeah, and was that part of the process something that you really enjoyed or you didn't like specifically?
It was challenging, and at first everyone was nervous to move and we kind of just stood still, but by the end of the process we're all rolling around on the floor, moving around, finding what works best and what doesn't. So.
And this was choreographed by Maria Gismondi, who's also a California graduate, right?
Yes.
Yeah. So do you guys enjoy working with her?
Yeah, of course. Maria's awesome to work with. She really, really understands the program, and it's crazy how much her and the director, Michelle Page, are like the same mind length about things, and they come up with the same ideas, and then they'll meet the next day and be like, hey, I had this idea, and I had that same idea, you know? So.
Yeah. Do you guys, so can you tell me a little bit about, without giving too much away, tell me a little bit about the story, just give me a little bit.
Okay. So the story is centered around Chris, who is a bottom line hotel employee who doesn't like her life. She doesn't get along with her family, and then all of a sudden she meets a guy and they kind of have like a connection, but not really. And then she goes down to Florida because one of her relatives had passed away. And then she has to deal with her family, and she meets some interesting characters in her family and along the way. And I think that's probably good, right?
I think that sums it up pretty good. Okay, so that was the short. So here's the short. I'm from another country. You have to give me the musical in one word. All right, ready? Go.
Funerals.
That's a good one. That's a good one.
Original.
Original, because it is an original musical written by Anthony and Dominic Carolla, Dominic is a student here at Cal U. Mm-hmm. So, one word.
Death.
Ooh, that's a very interesting one. All right, how about you?
Oh, one word. Ooh, exciting.
All right. Awesome. Wonderful. All right. So out of all the numbers in the show, do you have a favorite number?
Yes.
Yes? Okay. Yeah.
May I? I'd say my favorite number is Sherman's song called Death is Such a Cold Dark Friend. It is great. It really strikes the emotion in me, at least. And it's sung beautifully by Nicholas Franzak. And it is, I think, the best song in this musical.
Care to comment?
It's not my favorite song. I think my favorite song is it's Come Departure Time. It's all about being at the airport and like leaving, but it also has metaphors of death and funerals in it as well. And it has a really like strong beat and rock to it, you know.
Solid. Good stuff. Hello, I'm here with Amelia and Mark, and they're also actors in the show. And I'd like to ask them, so compared to the other process, because you guys have been in other musicals before, How has this process been different? So,
Well, with other shows, you have other people who have played the roles. You can look back at that. In most cases, there's like cast recordings you can listen to, at least get an idea of, oh, this is what they could sound like. This is how they might talk. With this, it's completely original. Didn't know what it was until, you know, we got the scripts. We were the first people to ever like play these characters, say these lines, sing these songs. So there's nothing really to like, you have like kind of just yourself to go off of, like, how is this character similar to me? How is it different? And that's definitely challenging to like figure out that balance.
To build it from the ground up, that is an achievement in itself.
Yes.
So bravo for both you and the rest of the cast for doing it. Do you share similar sentiments?
I agree completely. I was going to say what Mark said. We basically like didn't have anything to go off of when we got these roles, and it was really a fun process getting to. We made these characters, you know, because they've never been done before. So we really got to. We got like little notes from what they should be, like what they saw in the character, but we really got to make them our own, which is the most special part, I'd say.
I think that's a really cool part. Is there a favorite part of the process in creating your character that you liked the most?
Favorite part of creating the character, I would say just figuring out, because my character is married to Eloise, who Sydney plays, and figuring out like what kind of relationship they had was very interesting to me. And we bounced back ideas to figure out this is how we want them to be, like normally, and then at this point in the scene, like this is we kind of like built their history together, and like even like where we think they might go after the musical, which was I thought that was a lot of fun,
creating expectations for them.
Yes.
Absolutely. So do you have And do you guys have a number? You have a specific number to sing? You have something where you kind of create even more of a character through song?
Yeah, I have a tango called the Take a Tango in mine, and I really feel that it was my character's, like, her emotions were so deeply put into that song. Like, she just says exactly what's on her mind and doesn't hold back.
Yeah.
And it was really fun to, like, get through the process of, like, learning the number and, like, just becoming more into the character as it grew. Mm-hmm.
Wonderful. Absolutely wonderful. So I'm from another country at this point, and I need the musical to be explained to me in one word. Could you tell me, just give me one word that explains this musical, sums it all up in a nice little package?
Family.
Family's a good one. How about you?
I'd say unique.
Unique, because this is, once again, original musical written by Dom and Anthony. How close did they work on the process when it comes to creating the musical?
They were very involved. They, at least one of them was at almost every rehearsal together. They're both at a lot, and they were very, like, even in rehearsal, like they would sit and watch, and, Dr. Page would ask them questions. Like, how do you feel about this? Do you like what she was made sure to very much like include what they thought of it, because, you know, it is like they helped create it, that she definitely wanted to make sure they had their own opinions. Like they kind of had an impact on how it ended up, coming to be.
Mm-hmm. Awesome. Wonderful. Care to comment?
Yeah, they were definitely very involved with it. I remember the one day we were out in the hallway with like Dom and Tony, and they were giving us like one word that they could like describe our characters with and like what they saw in our characters. And it was interesting to see like what they wanted and put it into like what we felt too. So they gave us side notes of like what they like what we could do to make them better, and like, oh, like maybe try doing this here in this scene, and a lot of side notes that really helped grow our characters even more from what we already had.
That's awesome. That's wonderful. So thank you guys for coming in and speaking with me. I love the bow tie. I'm a little bit biased, though. Hello, I'm here with Maya. She's an assistant stage manager here for Yet Another Funeral. And actually, she showed up a little bit late. She came running in. What were you doing up there?
I was respiking the stage so that the actors could put the props where they need to go.
Sorry. See, the ASMs are the unsung heroes of the theater, along with the SMs. So can you explain to me what an ASM does?
Basically, whatever the stage manager tells us to do and whatever she can't handle on her own, we are there to help her.
Mm-hmm. And so that could mean anything, right?
Basically, yeah. If she hasn't eaten and she needs food and she's been in the theater all day, I will run and go grab that for her.
That's a solid heroic move at some points, because, you know, sometimes people need to eat. No, always people need to eat.
Yes.
So, So, what is your experience with Yet Another Funeral?
Well, this is my first time ASMing. I've never done anything behind the scenes before, but basically, I stay in the wings during the show. I'm on a headset, and I just make sure everything flows smoothly. The actors have what they need. If they need any help, they could either ask me or Lisa, the other ASM, and we'll get it done.
And she's busy off doing other things, right? So it's...
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. She's really busy right now.
Yeah. So, and what? How do you feel about Yet Another Funeral? Do you like it? Do you love it? Do you even more love it?
It's grown on me. It's grown on me. With an original musical, obviously, building characters and stuff from the ground up is difficult. But it's been an awesome process. I really enjoyed it. Even though I'm not acting in the show, I've thoroughly enjoyed it. I've learned all the music. I love it. It's awesome.
Do you dance in the wings whenever the numbers happen?
Oh, most definitely. The pit is awesome.
Yeah? Yeah. Oh, so are you on right next to the instruments?
I am directly next to the orchestra, yes. Yeah.
Do you enjoy listening to them often?
Yeah. They're awesome. I like the trumpet. He's funky.
Yeah. Good stuff. All right. Absolutely. So thank you. Thanks for coming in. Awesome. So thanks for taking up the time in your busy, busy schedule. So what are you off to do now?
I'm about to go change into my all black so that I'm not seen by the audience.
Hello, I'm here with Jesh, Kitty, and Katie, two different people, who are actors in the show. And could you guys tell me a little bit about your characters? What's your names?
My name is Grant. Really the best way to describe him is he's a schmuck who doesn't go away. That's really the best way to describe him. I mean, he's kind of that scratch you can't itch, because if you scratch it, it's going to get infected, and it'll just be a problem for everyone.
And you?
My character's name is Alice. She's just very picky, very touchy, always thinks she's right, mm-hmm. Stubborn. Mm-hmm.
I play the character of Cheryl, and Cheryl is dating Grant. And Cheryl is a bitter old drunk, basically in a nutshell.
So something that we've been talking about for a lot of the people, the actors that have come in, and some of the other people, is that this original musical, you're creating the characters from the ground up. That's one thing that's different about the process, because you guys have been in musicals before. Mm-hmm. What sets this musical in its process apart from others?
For me personally, I looked at the age first, and then of course I had to look at the script, and I was thinking in my head, who can I look at on television, in a movie, whatever, and that's how I started my process. And then I took bits and pieces from different actors and actresses and made my own character. Mm-hmm. So
absolutely. Did you guys enjoy the process, and what parts were great about it? What parts were not great about it? So, what part did you enjoy the most about creating a character?
I definitely appreciated the ability to experiment that we were given. Usually, you have parameters that you're given. We've talked about this, that you have parameters set when you have a show that you're doing. Like if you're in town, they have specific characters that they had to follow. Whereas this is completely unoriginal. This is completely original. We set the standard. So, working with DP, she would let us do whatever we want with the character.
Who is DP?
Oh, Dr. Pageant. Dr. Pageant would let us do whatever we wanted to do with our characters. And if she thought it was too much, she'd be like, okay, well, maybe let's work with it. See how we can do that even better. And it worked, and it was a lot of fun to actually develop our own characters and have our name basically on something.
Mm-hmm. What is all of your favorite numbers in the show? Is there a musical number that you guys enjoy a lot in the show? Is there something that just stops the show? You're like, I gotta watch this number.
I would probably say Game of Attrition. I'm not in Game of Attrition because, you know, something happens to me and it's very upsetting. So Game of Attrition definitely is one of my favorites because it brings the whole family together and everyone a part of Chris's life. She is stuck in a transition where she can't get out of. And the fact that every single person she's come in contact with thus far, including her family, is there. And she experiments while they are frozen to just reflect on what they've done with her and how they've affected her in some way. And it's very open... eye-opening and inspirational whenever you watch the entire musical together.
Speaking of experimental, I've been finding out that the movement that is kind of related with this is also very experimental. Do you guys care to comment on the dance movement that you guys have been learning as creating a character?
It's very different. This is my first college experience in theater. So like I'm coming in expecting like big stuff, whereas
the razzle dazzle.
Yeah, yes, I'm expecting to, you know, be doing like Newsies, where I'm sitting here where like it's very simplistic what we're doing, and it's very Spring Awakening. Like that's what they showed us. They showed us clips from Spring Awakening. They said like, all right, see how these characters take the choreography they're given, and they internalize it into themselves. And we have our own physical movements that kind of describe our characters that we do throughout the show. It's very interesting because I've never had to do anything like this before. It comes with a process that, like, I found I was questioning myself if what I was doing was right or not. But I found out as you go, it's not what's right. It's what gels, mm-hmm. which is kind of the same thing, but it's different because it's either yes or no, but you can make anything gel if you really want it to.
Okay, I'm from a different country, and I need the entire musical summed up in one word. Can you give me one word to sum up the entire musical?
Death.
Chaos. Separation.
Hello, I'm here with Josh, Aaron, Zachary? Zachariah. Thank you. Oh, that's very good. Zachariah, Kate, and Caitlin. And you guys are all, is this your first time with CalU Theater, CalU Music and Theater? I got to get that right, because it's going to be different. Is this your first time doing a musical with CalU Music and Theater?
Yes.
Yes? What drove you guys to audition for the musical?
Well, I'm a theater major, so I figured, why not? And plus, it's an original musical, so it's a wonderful opportunity for me and for everyone in the cast, because it's something new and special.
Solid, yeah.
For me, I'm a senior, so I'm graduating in May, and I wanted a new opportunity to do something new. And I went ahead and auditioned. Dr. Eikach pushed me to it, so.
Dr. Eikach, who is the Department of Music chair, who's directing, actually. He's the musical director mm-hmm. for the show itself, so he's got an involvement. You're a music major, correct?
Same.
And you're a music major as well. So did you guys have some sort of drive there to be a part of the musical from there?
Well, as said before, it's a brand new musical that's been written and never premiered before, and that's a great opportunity to be a part of. And as a musician, I always look for new and interesting things in the world of music just to put out there. And it's great to have somebody as talented as Dominic Carolla writing the music to from CalU, no less.
Yeah, he's a student, and he made an original musical from the ground up. Is there, so as members of the cast, is there... you guys play several characters, right? Multiple characters. So you have multiple characters to make. Is there a difficulty in that sort of process? Because you have to be like, well, I'm a bellhop now, or I'm this now, or I'm that now. What's the most difficult part of creating so many characters?
Personally, I think the most difficult part would have to be just changing the mindset, because you go on stage and you're one character, you come off and you start thinking, okay, I have to be a completely different person, sometimes the complete opposite of what you just played. So that's what I think would be the hardest part.
Yeah. Care to comment?
Yeah, I think one of the biggest things is the details, because like I play a desk clerk, an Indian desk clerk, at one point in the show, and I'm very reserved and very, we'll say, edgy. And then I come back later as an older gentleman, and I'm kind of like a curmudgeon, always scowling at someone. And it's sometimes when I'm on stage, I'll still be in that headspace where I'm like edgy and like held back, and then I gotta be like, and just really get into that mindset, and it's a cool switch.
So, and making different characters, do you have to sing differently for each character? Is it all pretty straightforward for all of them?
It's pretty different for each character, because you want to be able to encapsulate that character's mood and their behaviors like immediately, considering you're only on stage for a short period of time, and then you have to go out and change right back into something completely different.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. All right. So I am from another country. I'm a foreign exchange student coming to see yet another funeral. And I need the entire musical summed up in one word.
What can that word be?
Chaotic.
Intriguing.
Different.
You stole mine. Jazzy.
I'd have to say sarcastic.
Sarcastic, that's a good one. So, out of all the numbers in the show, which one is your favorite?
I'd have to say Sherman's song, Death is Such a Cold Dark Friend. It's really heartbreaking to see such a character who is so lovable go through such a terrible time, and you'll have to watch the musical to find out.
Interested. I'm intrigued now. All right. Thank you all. I appreciate everybody coming in. I have a large group of people that are moving and moving onwards to create a new show. Hello, I'm here with Sabrina, who is the set designer for Yet Another Funeral. So, biggest thing in creating a musical is having a specific style. What cultural centers, what influences did you draw from in order to create Yet Another Funeral?
Well, we had talked about just kind of what the musical meant, like, you know, and we wanted to use projections, and so that kind of drove a lot of the set design. Was one, not having that projection screen that's like the square, like you're at a presentation at a seminar or something, and like different ways of framing the projections on the stage, and also keeping Chris kind of separated from this like bright, happy world of the projections, so that you notice there's a lot of like, she's downstage with things, and there's like a wall or a drop in between her and, you know, this bright, vibrant life. So that's kind of...
It's interesting to think that projections are actually sort of becoming the new thing. They're becoming a very, very big part of many large Broadway productions. What was the most difficult part of pulling these projections together?
Well, for me, it was the compromise, because Deb was a projection designer, and it was this compromise between her and DP on where the screen would go. Because, of course, like, you know, as a set designer, I want lots of space on the set so that I can have, you know, room for scenery. But she needed more throw distance so we could get a bigger image. So at one point, the three of us just stood on the stage and kind of decided where we were going to hang the screen. Mm-hmm. Like, that was a big, like we moved downstage further than I would have. But we have some nice big images now, so that's pretty cool.
So in designing and building the set, what's one big major moment in the show that you believe, through collaboration, just became a much better part of the show? Like, through working with your artistic staff, is there a moment in the show that you really enjoyed? You didn't enjoy it first, but once everything came together, it became really beautiful?
I don't know if there was any that I didn't enjoy at first. I mean, I like the idea that that we had fairly, like, the scenery is fairly minimal in the scene, and it's a very tight color palette. It's not monochromatic, it's like blue and maroon and stuff, but it's like everything is kind of the same couple pieces that are moved around and whatever. And kind of just through lots of different characters coming on with the different costumes and things, and the different projections, we changed the locations. And I kind of like that, the fact that it's like, you know, it sets this tone that like her world is very confined. You know, it's the same three chairs rearranged over and over again in different ways.
How close did you work with Dominic and Anthony in creating this set design? What did they tell you what they liked, what they didn't like? What was how closely did they work on the project?
Well, the initial design meeting was DP and Dom and I, and we talked about what he really wanted to see on stage. And you see that the pianist is on stage, because originally that's what he wanted. One of the things he wanted was that, like, can we have the orchestra on stage? And in the end, it's just the you know, we compromised, and it's just the pianist on stage. But, like, you know, the orchestra isn't in the front where they traditionally are. They're in the wings. Mm-hmm. And so that was kind of the jumping off point. And then so that and the projections kind of influenced how the rest of it, the set went. And, yeah, I don't know.
Do you have a favorite number in the show?
Oh, I really like Game of Attrition a lot. That's the one that's stuck in my head right now. Anyway, so.
Awesome. Looking forward to seeing what you've built from the ground up. That's a set design pun.
Well, actually, everything comes from the... It's all flown in, so it comes from the grid down.
Oh, it comes from the grid down. And I'm here with Jess, who is the props design master of ceremonies for props. Do you have a title for that?
Props coordinator.
Props coordinator. That's a solid title. So were you? What exactly does that entail as props coordinator?
finding the props that we need and making ones that we can't find.
Yep. Approximately how many props did you find, acquire, and or make for yet another funeral?
I'm not sure. A lot.
Can you give me a rough estimate?
Probably 100 at least.
That's a lot. And what's amazing about it is that it's you're kind of making it out from an original musical. Because it's an original musical, you have to create all of these props. How close did you work with Dom and Anthony in finding these props, creating these props? Did they ask? Did they pretty much ask what they wanted, or did you kind of have some sort of say in that?
Sometimes I had some say, but usually I would get the list of what they wanted and what it needed to look like.
Mm-hmm. What was the most difficult thing to find?
Coffins.
Coffins. What would you need coffins for in a musical called Yet Another Funeral?
For funeral scenes.
Yeah, that would make sense. Absolutely. I was thinking more like a bar scene or something like that. So, yeah. So, how did you guys find coffins then?
Sabrina ended up finding them. One was used at a scare house. So it was originally covered in blood, and we had to clean all the blood off and clean it up.
Mm-hmm. Did you take a nap in the coffin?
No.
Oh, maybe that's good you didn't take a nap in the coffin, or that one specifically, the one that had blood in it. So is there any other prop that you're super excited that got to make it on stage?
I really like the menu because I got to work on that myself and make it.
Cool. Awesome. So is there anything, so out of all the numbers in the show, out of all the characters, all the people, what's your favorite character? What's your favorite line of dialogue? Do you have a favorite thing from that show?
I really like the number where they're at the hotel all dancing and singing. That's probably one of my favorites. Mm-hmm. And I really like pretty much all the characters. They're really interesting and fun.
All right, so I'm a foreign national from some other country, and I need to see this show. Give me one word to describe Yet Another Funeral.
First thing that comes to your head.
Mysterious.
Mysterious. I would get behind that. Absolutely. So, all right. Thank you, Jess. I appreciate you coming out and building everything from the ground up. That's a joke that I used last time, but it works this time. Hello, I'm here with Dom and Anthony Carolla, the brain children behind Yet Another Funeral. And they're brothers. So if you were to go back 10 years in time and talk to your brother and say, we're going to collaborate on a musical, we're going to create it all from the ground up, what would they say?
I think Tony would be very surprised.
Why do you think he would be very surprised?
Because he was surprised when I approached him with that about a year ago.
So you wrote the book behind Yet Another Funeral.
Yes, I wrote the book. It's been quite a journey. We never, Dom said, come write a musical. And I had no idea what to write. And so it was very development. It developed over a long period of time, just starting off with funerals. A lot of funerals in one family. And from there, we developed this story. Mm-hmm. And so it's been a long journey and quite an interesting one.
Yeah, it's from what I've heard, you guys have been completely involved in the process, being at rehearsals, being in close touch with the artistic team and Dr. Pagin. So you started with funerals. What sort of cultural centers, influences did you draw from in writing the music?
I think that I wanted to, in the music, communicate a kind of modern contemporary feel. I think in the book, we wanted to have something that was very much representative of real, genuine people. And I wanted the music to kind of be very, very an apt description of how people would speak to people today.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. So this dynamic that you guys have had throughout the 3-4 month process, I guess how long has this process been going? So
I think it probably began around September, maybe a little earlier. Does that sound right? I'm not sure exactly. It's been developing for a long time.
I started working on the songs 2 Decembers ago, and at that point, it was just, they were songs. There was not really a strong concept. I was coming up with songs and coming up with concepts based on the songs, and then I threw the concepts to Tony and said, could you actually write something that would, could you flesh this out? Mm-hmm. So.
Yeah. So do you guys, so what's the dynamic between you two? So whenever something's going really well between the two of you, how do you guys communicate that to each other?
I think when something's going really well, we both we both understood it. You know, Dom is always, I think, a little more excited about it. And I was excited too, you know. I don't really know.
That's all good. So you guys, so this dynamic is really cool because we have a set of brothers writing the musical, but you guys have a third brother. You have a brother named Vince, right?
Right.
Right, and he's playing in the pit. Actually, he's right over there. You want to come up? Yeah. So even though you've been, so these guys have written, composed, and now you're coming along, and you're just, so how did you get involved with this?
Well, Dom asked me, I guess a couple months ago, you know, would you be willing to play in the pit? And I was excited, you know, just the play, the music, and just the premiere of something new. And I got to read the first drafts of the book, hear the music for the first time, so I've just been very involved in it, I feel, and it's just been great to be part of it.
So when you read it the first time, were you just like, I have to be in this show?
After all my critiques, yeah, I mean, after corrections and stuff. But after that, yeah, I was like, you know, if I could have a part, and then Dr. Eyecatch approached me, and I was, any way I could help out.
How close was the collaboration with Dr. Eyecatch?
I would say in terms of creating the musical itself, I would say that was pretty close. Tony and I were pretty much the complete arbiters of that.
That's awesome, because you guys had a clear idea of what you wanted, and you guys were able to meet that through collaboration. So.
Yes, I wouldn't say clear idea. I would say that it was something that came along very quickly. Not quickly, it came along gradually as we went through the process. So a lot of it was about, it was us growing off of one another and saying, this is where I'm taking it. And then Tony would take it somewhere differently and I have to format what I was doing. And so it was something that came along gradually. I don't think we ever had a really clear conception of where this would end up.
No, we didn't at all.
Does this dynamic work? Have you guys ever considered maybe writing music together or just doing something else of the sort?
Yes, I've considered doing this again.
Yeah. Good stuff. Awesome. All right. So I'm a foreign national from some other country, and I need to see this musical. I need to see it, but I can only understand one word in English. What is that word?
That's a very odd question.
It's a good question though, isn't it?
I don't know.
Just sum up the musical in one word.
Loss.
Journey.
Acceptance.
That's two words, but that's a good word.
I trumped loss. Yeah. I like acceptance better.
That acceptance is a good word. That's a good word.
Funeral.
Funeral. That's one of the words in the title. So thank you guys. I appreciate it. You guys, I'm so glad that you guys were able to bring something to Calu like this. Hello, I'm here with Dr. Hugo Eyecatch, who is the chair of the music department and also the music director for Yet Another Funeral. So what was the drive to bring a musical to workshop here in the Mon Valley?
Well, first off, I think it's terribly exciting to be a part of something like this, and what better way to learn than to actually do? And I will have to correct you on one thing. I'm now the co-chair of the Department of Music and Theater. So this is an absolute wonderful marriage, and I think it's symbolic of putting the best of both worlds together and coming up with something really special, and this is very special.
Mm-hmm. How do you think the students will benefit from something so original coming out of California University?
Well, I think necessity is the mother of invention, and I think when you have no choice but to put forth something, you'll figure out a way to make it work, and we have. We've had ups and downs and bumps, and we've learned as we've gone on this journey, and I think it's one thing to learn about things theoretically. It's another thing to put them into practice and actually do it, and I think every cast member, if you ask them, will talk about how much they've learned, how much they've enjoyed, how much they'll hopefully remember from this. What a wonderful experience to take with you. And I know I'll remember it, until my dying day, I'm sure.
What about the students off stage, the audience that are coming in to see something completely original? How do you think they will benefit?
Well, I hope they'll look at it and say, that's so cool to have something done absolutely from scratch here. And I think it's just a wonderful moment for both departments here coming together and doing something like this, and certainly the students can benefit from it. As an audience member, you could say, wow, they really are doing new, interesting, and innovative stuff at CalU, and there's worse things they could say about us, certainly, than that.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. So how dark is it backstage working with the orchestra?
How dark? You mean dark humor, or do you mean?
I mean light-wise. These are lights, and how dark is it out there, and how is it working with an entire orchestra of people right next to the stage?
Well, obviously it presents a number of problems when you're off stage. It is a little dark, but I found through the stand lights I can make quite a number of shadows, puppets for the orchestra that they tend to enjoy. It's just part of doing the show. Sometimes you're up, sometimes you're down, sometimes you're in front of the stage. You always just make it work, and we do.
Mm-hmm. So, and how closely did you work with Dom and Anthony in creating the musical and bringing the idea to fruition? Because as this new department has come to be, this is such an amalgamation of things to happen. So how did this all come about?
Well, Dom has done just amazing work, and his source material that he came with was so good to start with. He brought song after song to me. We'd sing through them. He'd play them. You know, I might make little suggestions here or there. Most of it had to do with prosody and making sure that unaccented words weren't accented and syllables, that type of thing. Really, the task was you know, all of his. I just stood by as a mentor and gave him reassurances when he needed it. And we worked through everything. We talked about orchestration and whatnot. And so my part was really more of a nurturing mentor, pointing in different directions. But he did all the work, certainly.
Absolutely. That's awesome. So what style of music do you think is What style of music do you think is misrepresented on Broadway and there isn't enough of?
There's very little banjo music on Broadway, but I'm not sure I'm an advocate of banjo music.
You could have added banjo to yet another funeral, maybe. Who knows?
Probably. It may have been funny. I love the Broadway stage, no doubt. There is a trend. The actors on Broadway are getting younger and younger. That's an alarming trend for us that are getting older and older. There tends to be a lot more rock singing. I'm old-fashioned in many ways. I love musicals in which it requires old-fashioned singing and playing. And nowadays, with microphones and everything else, I would love to see productions with no microphones and just smaller, intimate venues, venues like this where you seat 100 people. You don't need to have a microphone coming out of your to be amplified. I think the natural performances are my favorite.
Okay, last question. Sum up the musical in one word.
Has people had trouble with this? Have you asked this before? I would say so can I have two words?
Sure.
Jazzy darkness.
That's a great way to put it, actually. So thank you. I appreciate it. Nice meeting you, Dr. Ettridge. Hello, I'm here with Deb and Evan, who are the lighting designer and an incoming student coming in fall 2016. That's wonderful. So how have you been involved with Yet Another Funeral?
I haven't really been involved with this show, but I was an assistant stage manager for the last show that happened here, so.
That's awesome. So you're being involved with the Department of Music and Theater so soon, even before you come here. As the lighting designer, what artistic centers, what influences did you draw from in order to create this interesting musical from the ground up?
This show was a little bit challenging because there were a lot of locations. So we had to create that with lighting and projection. There were funeral homes, a lot of interior locations, hotels. Am I giving things away if I say too much of this?
No, absolutely not.
A couple of exterior locations, a wedding, city skylines, some vistas, some big panoramic views, and that was kind of fun.
And so you designed the projections as well?
Yes.
So projections are something that are just, they're really starting to take off in the theater everywhere. What were some of the limitations, challenges, but also advantages of using projections in Yet Another Funeral?
Well, one of the biggest limitations in this space was we wanted to use rear projection because we didn't want to project through the actors, and we didn't have a lot of distance to physically accomplish the geometry of that. So we use two dance mirrors, and we are projecting with three projectors from the scene shop. The center projector is dead on from the back of the scene shop through the garage door. So we had to be innovative. And then we have two dance mirrors that we had to project from the side, and then the light bounces off of that and around the corner. So that was a challenge.
That's super interesting, though. I never would have thought to have done like that. I have very little experience with projections to begin with.
What was the
drive to, in order to bring a musical to workshop and create in the Mon Valley?
Well, I think that came from Dom and Tony. It was something that they've been working on for 2 years now. And
how closely did they work on the process with you, designing these places?
I didn't come in until closer to the end, because they've been working on it for 2 years, and I only started in August of the past fall. Mm-hmm. But we started talking about design decisions and concepts before Christmas. So Sabrina Hikes Davis is the scene designer, and the director, Michelle Pagin, and I and Dom had gotten together to start talking about how we could create these locations and still fit an orchestra in and have the depth that they need for staging, but still have some depth for the projections, which pushed things forward, made them a little more intimate.
It's a lot to think about. It's actually a lot to take in. So when you see when you hear people talk about that, are you excited to see what the fall semester has to bring in creating something like that, or even as being an actor or being involved in the theater department?
Oh, I'm so excited. Like, I focus more on like the backstage stuff. So whenever I see a show, I'm always looking at like, how's the scenery moving? What kind of lights are there? Like, I'm always trying to learn from everything I watch.
And what better way to be learning, getting experience from here at California with an original musical, no less. So thank you guys. I appreciate you guys coming out, and hope to see you guys soon enough. Hi, I'm here with JP and Emery here on the red carpet. So, and you're a member of the faculty here at the Department of Music and Theater.
Correct.
What was the drive in order to bring and workshop a musical? How do you think that benefits the students here?
Oh, man, put me on the spot. I think this is a wonderful opportunity to explore some of the talents that we have here and, you know, experiment with all the assets we have here in terms of facility, team, in terms of production team and creative team, and, you know, give the students a chance, say hi. Give the students a chance, you know, to see an experimental work in progress. So, you know, ultimately there's an end goal, I believe, for this project, and it's to see it, go beyond CalU. But this is a place to, you know, get its sort of, you know, foundation and build and learn from the process. And, you know, I don't know much about the process because I'm not a member of the production team, but I've seen it last night. I saw great things, and I think that there's great things to come.
Absolutely. And even as a member of the faculty, you can see where this process is going to go from here. So, what part of the show did you most enjoy when you watched it last night?
Oh man, let me see. I think I did not see the end coming, and when I saw after about 20 minutes until the end, I'm like, now I see where we're going. So I really enjoyed how the Grim Reaper character sort of, you know, played through the entire piece and how the humor really built in the second act. I think there was a lot of really, really cool work in terms of movement, and I think it challenged the students, but I enjoyed watching them, you know, engage that challenge and try to conquer that challenge. And, you know, that was really enjoyable for me. So in terms of narrative, I enjoyed the Death character, and in terms of performance, I really enjoyed how they explored movement.
Yeah. So as someone who knows movement very well, is there something, do you think that students offstage, the audience, will pick up on certain things based upon the movements?
Hopefully. You know, I think it's unique and, you know, different than probably what is expected from a traditional musical. But I think that it's established very early on, and once the audience starts to understand that and sort of sees this repetition with movement sort of play throughout in each individual character, they'll buy in right away, most definitely.
How do you think the students feel about opening night?
probably scared, probably exhausted, probably excited, probably ready to, you know, blow their lid and just, you know, rock out and knock it out of the ballpark. So all of those things, most definitely.
Sounds like you're very proud of them.
I am what I saw. And, you know, I'm proud of the facility and I'm proud of the faculty and I'm proud of the just the whole team and everything we're doing here. It's exciting.
Hello, I'm here with Brian. Brian Eisminger, right? That's how you pronounce it, right?
Eisminger.
Eisminger, okay. Yes. I'm going to try and get that right. So how are you involved with the theater department?
I'm currently part-time faculty. I teach voice and I manage the practicums of the theater students.
So you're in charge of the people who make things work in Yet Another Funeral, among other shows.
Yes, in some ways, I guess you could say that. Every theater student has to take a practicum, and so I just oversee. I am in contact with the students and also with their supervisors.
So. We're here, Red Carpet, Yet Another Funeral. It's a amazing original show that it's just come out of the woodwork, so to speak. And you got a chance to see it last night.
I did.
So we have a little bit of a special surprise happening the night before. What did you think?
I thought it was great. I was the experience was wonderful. Knowing that the students wrote the show, that it was student written, both the book and the music. It was the only experience I've ever had like that, actually.
Yeah.
And, you know, I'm not going to lie. I have thought of writing my own show someday and don't know that will ever happen. But seeing someone else doing it and seeing a show being born from the very beginning, that was great.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. You know, there's always a drive. There should be that drive. So, but even so, there's more. You kind of created your own show this semester, I've heard. You kind of headed a cabaret here with the Department of Music and Theater.
Yes, well, we're very excited about the upcoming opportunities in the department. Am I allowed to talk about I don't want to give anything away, no. Yes, we will have a concentration in musical theater. And so we've already begun planning courses and new curriculum in that regard, and we would like to provide as many opportunities as possible for our students, and we thought that the cabaret would provide such an opportunity.
What style of music do you think is misrepresented on Broadway?
Misrepresented?
Or underrepresented?
Or underrepresented. On today's stage, I don't know. I enjoy what's out there now. I like the rock. I like that, you know, the rock style. I like that there's jazz on Broadway. I don't know that I can say, I don't know that I can identify any particular type of music that's underrepresented.
Okay. Maybe synthwave, but that's me.
Colors. I like musical color. I like vocal color. I like it all.
Absolutely. But even so, like even seeing Yet Another Funeral, it's a whole different color, right?
It is. It's dark. It certainly has a jazz element. It's even organic at times. I think it's I want to say oozy, flowy.
That's a great way to describe it, actually. So yeah, thank you, Brian, for coming in and giving us your colorful approach. Hello, I'm here with Dr. Michelle Pagin and Maria Gismondi, who are really, 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 really involved. How are you guys involved with the show?
I directed it.
Ah, and you?
I am the choreographer.
Okay. So a lot of movement happening, a lot of direction happening there. So what was the drive to bring a musical to workshop in the Mon Valley?
Well, when Dom and I had sort of a random conversation after the final performance of Miracle on 34th Street, the musical, in 2014 was when we had that conversation, and he wasn't looking forward to his assignment of working on the show because he wasn't a fan of musicals. And so kind of jokingly at the end on the last performance, I said, well, how was it? And he said, it wasn't as bad as I was expecting. And I said, oh, well, good. And that's when he said, you know, I think I might actually try to write a musical myself. And I said, well, we've got a department full of people who would love to breathe life into something that you've written. If you want to give something a listen or have us read it, we'd be happy to do so. And that's when it all began. We started conversations back and forth. He wanted a whole repertoire of musical theater shows to pull from because he wasn't familiar with musicals. So I was sending him things all the time, just dropping nuggets here and there. And that's how it began.
That's amazing. That's awesome. So what do you think? What do you think the drive is for putting a musical out here?
Okay, little known fact. During the rehearsal process for Miracle on 34th Street, the musical, Dom and I walked out to our cars together one night, and we started talking about him writing new music for the department, potentially for the department. And I said, yeah, of course you should do that. There's people here that would eat that right up, right? And we talked about like some different styles, and so I like to give myself credit for inspiring Dom to write the musical Yet Another Funeral. But no, truly, as far as why I think it happened, not to mention that aside from the fact that Dom is already like an amazing writer and his music is incredible, why it went from pre-production to production is because it was an amazing opportunity for the students. For a student in undergraduate level of training to have the opportunity to originate a role in an original musical is really, really rare. And, you know, it's great practice because sometimes some of the first jobs people get is workshops. And that doesn't mean that you ever get to be the people that portray the role in the end, but a lot of times you'll get hired to do, say, a reading or to do, you know, the beginnings of a show, and you're figuring out the blocking, you're giving life to a character that then eventually goes to the Great White Way and you say goodbye to it. So this is good practice. It's an amazing chance for them.
Absolutely. So were you, and from what I've heard, you're actually a graduate of Cal U. Coming, so how is it to come back and choreograph in a completely original musical?
It's amazing. Truly, the style of movement that Dr. Pagen and I agreed on from an early stage in the production, I think, we knew that we had to have a completely different movement vocabulary than a typical musical theater show. So for me, that was very exciting because to be able to work in that capacity is really rare in the theater. Now, in dance, not so rare, but in musical theater, this kind of contemporary style movement is not something that you typically see a lot of on the stage. And that was amazing for me because that's the kind of stuff I really gravitate toward. And I have done several shows with Michelle now. And, you know, most of the stuff we get to do together is more in the traditional vein. So this was really fun because it was very contemporary. So yeah, it was incredibly enjoyable.
What sort of artistic centers, influences did you draw from in order to kind of create Yet Another Funeral from the ground up?
That's a lengthy one.
You can start with the musicals that you sent Dom.
Oh, I sent him some quote-unquote traditional musicals. I sent him Oklahoma and The Music Man, just to kind of give him a sense of how things were originally. But then I also sent him West Side Story because they started to use music and dance differently. And I sent him Urinetown because we were doing it then the next semester. And I just thought he needed to hear it because it's a show I love anyway. And I sent him Spring Awakening, which really had unique, when it was performed on Broadway originally, it really had a unique movement style, and it was a period book but with contemporary music. And I recommended Violet to him, and just all sorts of things so that he could get an idea, because there's so many ways he could do it. And he said he was thinking that he would do things a little more contemporary, which I was excited about. And as he started sending me pieces, and I would read something, I'd say, you know, or I'd listen to something, well, that sounds a lot like this, and I would send another show to him, and he'd go, oh, okay. So that's kind of how that happened. It was exciting to just keep throwing him nuggets of shows and having him listen, and then we could, you know, talk about it back and forth and that sort of stuff.
Basically giving him a crash course in all of musical theater. So that is pristine. So out of all of the numbers in Yet Another Funeral, which one is your favorite? It's going to be a difficult one, but, you know, just narrow, even if it's a two, it's fine if it's two.
Well, I'm going to back up and start this in a different place.
Go ahead.
When Dom and I were talking about the music, because when you read the book, you get a very clear feel of how things go. And then whenever you listen to the music, they seem to be opposing each other. And I had a conversation with Dom, and it has lived with me, and I just keep ruminating on it about in the daily lives, which is represented through the dialogue moments through the book, the characters keep their walls up and they don't really say what's on their mind. They don't let themselves feel. But then when they sing, that's their internal voices coming out and their emotion and their heart. And that was so clear once you put the music and the book together. And so the songs are just so evocative of struggles and pain and curiosity and loss, but not necessarily loss through death. And I think I'm tied between Departure Time and Game of Attrition. Those two songs I really, really like. But I like the sister song. I just like there is it's a lot.
It's hard to pick.
It is
because it is something that you've built and you've made your own. So
when I wake up in the morning, though, I have to say consistently there is Departure Time in my brain is what's in my brain.
And favorite number for you?
I think musically, the one that gets me every time is Do You Remember? I cannot handle that one. I shed tears almost every time I hear it. And the movement that I've contributed to that is really limited, so it's not even like it's this huge like dance number and that's why I like it. No, it's that one I just think emotionally strikes some kind of deep chord in me, and I don't know what Dom did to make that happen, but I think he's just incredibly talented, and that song in particular just lives with me. But also Departure Time. I enjoy Departure Time movement-wise as well. And for me, all of this, all of the music he's written, a lot of it is really emotionally true to life. And I think when people see the show and when I heard the music for the first time, it reminded me of different times of my own life or different relationships that I've had, different experiences I've had in my life. So I think that calls that to the forefront in a lot of ways for most of the movement. So even working with the kids, I would say to them, you know, this reminds me of this time when I got broken up with in Brooklyn and it broke my heart. And so now Kayla and Clayton, you're going to do this, right? And this is what it's going to look like because this is what it felt like to me. How can we translate that into movement? So those moments are special for me too. But musically, hands down, I think. Do You Remember the sister song?
Absolutely. All right. I'm a foreign national. I need the entire show wrapped up in 1 to 2 words. Can you give me that?
Oh, you're giving me 2 words?
One or two. Yeah.
Simply complex.
How about you?
Introspective.
Very good. Wonderful. Thank you, guys. I appreciate it. Hi, I'm here with Dr. Steve Whitehead, who is the Associate Provost of Innovation, and also his family has been joining us. So what exactly could you sum up what the Associate Provost of Innovation does here at CalU?
Yeah, basically I'm in charge of a tech fees for the university, so I'm in charge of the technology in the classrooms, and I'm also in charge of like community outreach and engagement. So different things going on. I was in charge of our center at South Point, different areas like that. I'm also in charge of, I helped write the strategic plan, just sort of a variety of roles.
That's awesome. So, and you guys have come here tonight to see yet another funeral. Have you guys heard anything about it? You guys know anything about it up to this point?
We know the composer,
yeah,
Dominic Carella.
Do you know him personally? Some connection with him?
He's our son's piano instructor.
Oh, very nice. So you play piano. So you have, do you have some sort of musical background? So you're going to be looking out for things tonight on the show?
Yeah, here and there, maybe. I don't do much piano, mostly guitar, saxophone, et cetera, et cetera.
That's cool. Awesome. So do you guys see theater? How often do you guys see shows like this come out here?
For CalU, this will be our first show, actually, that we've come and seen, besides A Miracle on 34th Street and some things like that. So yeah. Outside of that, we do go down to Pittsburgh and see shows. My wife's traveled to New York for numerous shows.
Yeah. So what are you guys expecting for tonight? What do you guys have expecting anything at all?
We just think it's going to be awesome.
Yeah. Good. That's
Dominic
awesome.
Did it? Yeah.
Yeah. So you have some sort of connection there. So, yeah.
We're expecting some humor. I expect to see some humor to it and some seriousness and a little bit of all that put together.
Good. Awesome. Wonderful. So, yeah. Thanks. Thank you guys so much for coming out here and being a part of something. Well, folks, there you have it. We've laughed, we've cried, we've made friends, and we've mourned over yet another funeral performed here at California University Department of Music and Theater here in Steele Hall. If you're interested in learning more about the theater degree or you want to get a career in theater, check us out on Facebook, CalU Theater and Dance, or @CalU_TD.